Welcome back. In this session, we're going to discuss the law of torts and various principles of the law of torts as have been used to ask questions in the CLAT exam. Okay, so let's begin. What is the law of torts? The law of torts is defined as a body of rights, obligations, and remedies that is applied by courts in civil proceedings to provide relief for individuals or victims who have suffered harm from the wrongful acts of others. So basically, it involves wrongful acts of someone which cause harm to the plaintiff. Okay, now in this particular situation in the law of torts, it's necessary to note that the law of torts was developed where statute failed. Okay, where statutory law failed to provide a remedy in case somebody suffered from a wrong to their legal right. Okay, that is when the law of torts came into play. Okay, that is why the law of torts was developed. Historically, the law of torts is basically judge-made law. Okay, it is a branch of law that has been developed by the courts. Okay, now the word tort has been derived from the Latin word tortum, which means to twist. It means conduct that adversely affects the legal rights of others and is thus wrong. Okay, so it involves the commission of a wrong or of a legal malfeasance, of something where somebody has violated a legal right. Okay, jurist Salmond has defined a tort as a civil wrong for which remedy is action in common law for unliquidated damages and which is not exclusively a breach of contract or a breach of trust or other equitable obligation. So basically, where remedy does not exist in the form of statute or in the form of a contract or in the form of a breach of trust, okay, and the remedy is in the form of unliquidated damages, that is damages which have not been specified. Okay, like for instance, in a contract, for violation of a contract, the contract itself mentions what are the damages to be paid by the breaching party. Okay, whereas in the case of tort, the damages are unliquidated. That is, it is not mentioned what the quantum of the damages are. Thus, essentially, a tort is a civil wrong which is not a breach of contract or a breach of trust. Okay, now development of the law of torts. The law of torts came up in the UK as a way of addressing wrongs that had been committed where there was no remedy available in statutory provisions. Okay, the formulation of the law of torts is guided by the maxim ubi jus ibi remedium, that is, if there is a transgression of a right, there must be a way to compensate for it, as a right has no value if there is no way to enforce it. Okay, it was designed to address the rights in rem of individuals, that is, rights in rem are rights against the world, not against any specific person, but against everybody. It was designed to address the rights in rem of individuals which had no protection under the laws of contract or trust. The law of torts as administered in India is the English law as found suitable to Indian conditions and modified by acts of the Indian legislature according to the principles of justice, equity, and good conscience. So basically, the courts look to apply the principles of justice, equity, and good conscience along with the principles of tort that have been settled in English law as have been applied to Indian conditions, okay, in dealing with the law of torts. Elements of the law of torts. Thus, the law of tort is as developed in India is an extension of English common law, which is judge-made law. It is fashioned as an instrument for making people adhere to standards of reasonable behavior and respect the rights and interests of one another. There are four elements to a tort, each of which needs to be present for a remedy to be provided. One, there should be a wrongful act or omission. Two, there should be a duty of care imposed by the law. Three, there should be legal damage or injury. And four, there should be a legal remedy that one is able to apply. Okay, we'll discuss each of these in greater detail. What is a wrongful act or omission? There must be some act or omission of a duty imposed by law on the part of the defendant. Okay, so there must be some overt act or omission which the law imposes, which the defendant has failed to carry out. For example, in the case of MCD versus Subhagwanti, a clock tower which was not in good repair fell and killed several people. The MCD was held liable for omission, okay, because it was its duty, it was its legal duty to maintain the clock tower in a good repair. Okay, although it was not expressly mentioned anywhere that this was the duty of the MCD, because the MCD was in charge of the clock tower, it naturally fell to them to maintain it in good repair. And since the clock tower fell because it was not in good repair, it was held that this was an omission on their part. Now, duty imposed by the law. The act or omission must be an action that must be required by the law, or the duty must be imposed by the law. This means that if an act that is prohibited by the law causes harm, it is liable under tort. Similarly, if the omission of an act that is required by law causes harm, then it is liable under tort. So if an act is prohibited by the law and the defendant still goes ahead and does it, it is liable under tort. And if an action was required, but there is an omission by the defendant, okay, then that omission is also liable under tort. For example, a driver is under duty of care to drive carefully. Thus, if a driver fails to drive carefully, it is an omission on his part. But if the worshippers stop going to a temple and thereby cause the priests to lose money, this action is not liable under tort. This is actually a case that happened where the priests of a temple sued the worshippers, saying that the worshippers had stopped coming to that temple, as a result of which the donations to that temple had dried up. Okay, as a result, they were unable to maintain the upkeep of the temple. Okay, but it was held that there was no duty on the worshippers to go to the temple and to provide donations. Okay, as a result of which this action was not liable under tort. Okay, now for example, in the case of Donoghue versus Stevenson, if you're discussing the law of torts, the case of Donoghue versus Stevenson will come up for a lot of discussion. It was basically a case where somebody purchased a drink, a sealed bottle of a drink, okay, from a shop, okay, and after they opened it, they found that there was a half decomposed snail inside. Okay, so who was liable for this action? Such a case had not happened before. Okay, so in this case, the courts considered whether the shop owner should be held liable in tort, or whether it's the manufacturer of the drink who should be held liable in tort. Okay, now it was held that the manufacturer of the drink and not the shop owner, because the manufacturer is selling the drink in such a state that the shop owner cannot intervene or cannot verify the quality of the drink. Okay, and thus has no legal duty. Okay, so because the drink was sold in a sealed bottle, it was the legal duty of the manufacturer, okay, toward the consumers, to ensure that the noxious substances are not present in the drink. Okay. Now, legal damage or injury. The act or omission must result in a legal damage or injury, that is, violation of a legal right vested in the plaintiff. Now, this is different from actual damage or injury. Okay. The legal damage or injury is basically refers to the violation of a legal right, as opposed to actual damage or injury. Now, legal damage may or may not result in actual damage. Actual damage may or may not be caused from the violation of a legal right or legal damage. Okay, so the two are different concepts. Okay, so what is required in the law of torts is that legal damage or injury should have been caused. Okay, this means that the act or omission must have caused a damage that is recognized by law as wrongful. For example, a person has a legal right to enjoy his property, and if someone throws trash in it, this is a violation of his legal right and is liable under tort. However, it is possible that a legal right is violated without causing any physical or real damage. This is explained in the maxim injuria sine damno. For example, in the case of Ashby versus White, the defendant wrongfully prevented the plaintiff from voting. So in that case, the plaintiff had come to cast his vote, and the defendant, who is the polling officer, wrongfully prevented the plaintiff from voting, although his name was present in the voting rolls. Okay. Now, it so turned out that the candidate that the plaintiff would have voted for won anyways. So there was no real damage caused. Okay, because the candidate who the plaintiff would have voted for won anyways. But at the same time, it was held that there was damage, there was hurt to the legal right of the plaintiff. As a result, the defendant was held liable even though there was no damage. On the other hand, it is possible that a person suffers a huge loss or damage, but none of his legal rights are violated, represented in the maxim damnum sine injuria. In such cases, there is no tortious act. Okay, for example, in the Gloucester Grammar School case, the defendant opened a rival grammar school in front of an existing one, thereby causing the fees of the school to be reduced from 40 pence to 12 pence. He was held as not liable as he did not violate any legal right of the plaintiff. Okay. Now, in the case of Usha Ben versus Bhagyalakshmi, that was a case in the UK. This is a case in India. In the case of Usha Ben versus Bhagyalakshmi Chitra Mandir, the plaintiff sought a permanent injunction, that is basically to prevent someone from doing certain action. You seek an injunction to prevent someone from doing a certain action. So the plaintiff sought a permanent injunction against a cinema house to restrain them from showing the movie Jai Santoshi Ma. It was contended that the movie represents the goddesses Lakshmi, Saraswati and Parvati in a bad light, which is offensive to the plaintiff. Now, in this case, it was held that hurt to religious sentiments is not recognized as a legal wrong, and since there was no violation of a legal right, an injunction was not granted. So again, what is required is the violation of a legal right or legal injury. Okay. In the case of Cheshmo versus Richards, the plaintiff had been drawing water from underground for past 60 years. The defendant sunk a borewell on his own land and drew a huge quantity of water, which diminished the water supply of the plaintiff. It was held that the defendant was not liable because he was only exercising his right and did not violate any right of the plaintiff. Okay, so in a law of torts, because the person, the defendant, was exercising his own rights without violating on his own land, without violating the rights of the plaintiff, okay, it was held that there was no wrong and there was no tortious remedy available. Okay, now for a tort action, there are two principal remedies that are available. One is damages, that is monetary recompense, and the other is injunction, that is preventing someone from doing something. Damages can be nominal, that is a tort is committed but the victim has suffered no loss. So as a result, only nominal damages are awarded. Nominal means for namesake. So the damages that are awarded are not a lot, but some damage is awarded as a recognition of the fact that a legal right has been breached. Okay. Contemptuous damages. This is where the court considers that the action should not have been brought and was without merit. So the court awards damages to the defendant instead of the plaintiff. Okay. The court awards damages against the plaintiff because it considers that the suit should not have been brought. Then aggravated damages, where the court feels that the tort was committed in a malicious manner. Okay. And as a result, it feels that extra damages should be awarded. And exemplary or punitive damages, where the court feels that the action committed by the defendant is shocking and an example needs to be made of them. Hence, punitive means in a form of punishment. Okay, exemplary or punitive punishment basically therefore means the damages awarded are excessive in nature as a way of making an example out of them, as a way of teaching them a lesson. Okay, now kinds of torts. The law of tort is ever evolving since there can be innumerable types of acts that can violate the legal rights of others. However, they can broadly be classified on the basis of how liability is incurred into three broad categories. Okay, one is intentional, that is wrongful acts that are done intentionally, irrespective of with or without malice. Hence, you look at whether the intention behind doing the act with or without the intention to cause harm. Okay, the next category is negligent conduct, wrongful acts that are done without any intention to cause harm, but because of not taking proper care that is required by the law. Okay. And finally, we come to the case of strict liability, acts that are neither intentionally done nor involve any negligence, but still cause an injury as propounded in the conditions given in the case of Rylands versus Fletcher. The defendant is held liable even if he acted reasonably. Okay. We'll discuss the case of Rylands versus Fletcher in greater detail later on. Now, aside from the aspect of how liability is incurred, torts can also be classified according to the type of damage. So you have physical torts, which are torts causing physical hurt to the body, such as assault and battery. It can happen with the intention of causing such hurt or even through negligence. Okay. Then you have abstract torts, that those which cause damage to mind or reputation, such as defamation. Defamation is injury to reputation. Okay. So it's an abstract tort. Okay. Torts involving property, for example, trespass to land. Torts involving legal right, for example, false imprisonment, where somebody restricts your movement from a certain place. Okay. And nuisance, that is causing unreasonable restriction toward the exercise of one's legal right. Okay. Now, defenses in tort law. There are a lot of defenses available in tort law. We'll briefly discuss the general defenses available in tort law. The following are the generally accepted defenses in tort law. One is vicarious liability, that is where the tort was committed by an employee while he was undertaking his duties or employment. That is, there was a close and direct relation, connection between the harmful act committed by the employee and what he was employed to do. then the employee can basically use this as a defense and pass off the responsibility, the liability on the employer. Okay, so this is the case of vicarious liability. Then you have contributory negligence. This is a defense used whereby the claimant, that is the plaintiff, was said to have acted in a careless manner when looking after themselves, which in fact had contributed to the injuries which they have suffered. So if the plaintiff acted in a careless manner, which resulted in part in him suffering from the injuries to his legal rights, okay, if the plaintiff himself can be blamed, okay, then that is contributory negligence, okay. So this basically involves negligence or careless action on the part of the plaintiff, okay. Hence the defendant can pass off part of their liability. Then you have the case of volenti non fit injuria. Translated simply, it means consent. Okay, it simply means that the claimant or the plaintiff cannot complain, whereby he voluntarily assumed the risk. The common example that is given is if you've gone to a party and somebody offers to drive you back to your house and you get into their car, okay, then you have voluntarily assumed all of the normal risks that come with sitting in a car, okay. And if the driver then acted in a reasonable and careful manner, okay, and an accident still happened, you will not be able to sue the driver because you consented to the normal risks that come with getting into a car, okay. Then you have the case of act of God, when something occurs over which you have no control and is affected or accentuated by forces of nature, then you are not liable in tort law for such inadvertent damage that may arise out of such. Okay, so as a result, basically, if something happens over which you have no control, for instance, you have a ship at sea and a storm comes, okay, and a devastating storm comes, okay, as a result, that is an action over which you have no control. So if the goods which are on the ship are lost, okay, you cannot hold the ship owner liable. However, if you were well aware of the risks and could have possibly taken steps to stop the wrongful act or damaging act, or have in any way mitigated it, then you cannot duck responsibility under this defense. So there is a proviso provided to the Act of God defense, which is that if there were, it was possible to take certain steps to mitigate the risks, and such steps, such reasonable steps were not taken, okay, in that case, the defense of Act of God cannot be claimed. Okay, then you have the case of plaintiff the wrongdoer. This is similar to the case of contributory negligence. Okay, if the plaintiff himself is guilty of a wrong and suffers an injury as a result of such wrong, then the plaintiff's case fails. For example, if the plaintiff trespasses on another's property and is bitten by a dog while trespassing on another's property, then in that case, the plaintiff himself is the wrongdoer, okay, as a result of which he suffered the damage to his legal rights, okay, as a result of which the plaintiff will not be able to claim under the law of torts, okay. Then we come to private defense. Nothing is wrong if done with regard to protecting one's own self, another's self, one's property, or another's property against a threat to such. Thus, private defense as a defense can be used when basically you or your property or somebody else or their property is under threat, okay, under physical threat, okay. So in that case, you have the right to retaliate with reasonable force, okay, against such threat. However, please note that the risk must be immediate and sudden, and the force used must be proportionate to the risk at hand. So the force used to repel such risk cannot be excessive. Okay. Inevitable accident. This is a defense that can be claimed under a situation where, in spite of taking reasonable care and protection, the harm could not be averted. This does not mean absolutely inevitable situations, which would fall under Act of God, but situations which are unavoidable even after taking necessary precautions with respect to the harm in question. So the defense of inevitable accident refers to what we commonly understand as accidents. Okay, like an accident on the road where you have taken reasonable care. Okay, where your car is well maintained, you're driving under the speed limit, you're driving properly, but still an accident occurs. Okay, because of somebody else. Okay, because of situations that are out of your control, because of situations that are unavoidable. Okay. So even after taking necessary precautions, if a situation occurs which causes harm to the plaintiff, okay, in that case, the defendant can use inevitable accident as a defense. Okay. Now we come to mistake. This refers to a case wherein a person was under mistaken knowledge and even after taking reasonable precautions, could not have been reasonably expected not to commit said mistake. Okay, so mistake, and this refers to mistake of fact or mistake of identity, not mistake of law. Okay, so mistake basically where reasonable care has been taken to try and avoid the mistake or to try and gain knowledge as regards the subject matter of the case, and still the plaintiff and still the defendant could not avoid the mistake. In that case, mistake can be used as a defense. Okay, then necessity. Under dire conditions, if one does something which results in a tort, then one can usually claim the defense of necessity. So it is in only in dire conditions where the options available are limited. Okay, if somebody does something which results in a tort, one can claim the defense of necessity. Such a condition should, however, come under the bracket of general good or greater good, and to prevent a bigger harm. So if basically to prevent a greater harm, you have violated somebody's legal rights and it was under dire conditions where your choices were limited, you can claim the defense of necessity. Okay, now you will notice that in all of these defenses, one common factor that is mentioned is that all of these must involve necessary precautions which have been taken on the part of the defendant. So generally in the law of torts, when necessary precautions or when necessary care has been taken on the part of the defendant, then he can claim from among these defenses. Okay, now we come to specific torts. The first of which is assault and battery, okay, which is a physical tort. Assault is an attempt or a threat to do corporeal hurt, that is hurt to the body, coupled with an apparent present ability and intention to do the act. So basically, assault involves an attempt or a threat to do bodily hurt along with an apparent present ability and intention to do the act. Contact is not necessary for a case of assault. Contact, however, is necessary in the case of battery. Okay, so if say for instance you threaten or you pretend to punch someone, okay, and so till the moment contact is made, okay, it is assault. The moment contact is made, it is battery. Okay, not every threat constitutes an assault. There must be in all cases the means of carrying the threat into effect. Okay, so it's not mere threat that constitutes assault. There must also be the means of carrying out that threat for it to constitute the tort of assault. A battery is the intentional and direct application of any physical force to the person of another. It is the actual striking of another or touching him in a rude, angry, revengeful or insolent manner. Thus, for example, again a common example that is given, to throw water at a person is assault, and if any drops touch him, it is battery. Okay? Now we come to false imprisonment. False imprisonment is the total restraint of the liberty of a person for however short a time without lawful excuse. So if somebody restrains the liberty of a person, it doesn't matter for how long, irrespective of long or short duration. Okay, if without lawful excuse, the liberty of a person is restrained, then that constitutes the tort of false imprisonment. There are two necessities to constitute this wrong. Total restraint of the liberty of a person. Now it can be actual restraint, that is physical restraint, or it can be constructive restraint, such as by show of authority. So if you are dressed as a security guard, okay, or a policeman, okay, and without lawful justification, you prevent someone from moving out of a certain area, then that is constructive restraint. Okay. Now the second necessity for false imprisonment is that the detention must be unlawful or without lawful justification. So if something is unlawful, that is something is contrary to the law, or if something is without lawful justification, that is something is not necessarily contrary to the law, but it is also, there is no justification for it. In that case, it constitutes the tort of false imprisonment. Okay, then we come to defamation. Every person has a right in rem, that is a right against the world at large, to have his reputation preserved inviolate, and a violation of this right through words or images, spoken or written, comprises a tort of defamation. There are three necessary components for a speech or writing to be defamatory. The words must be defamatory, that is, they must have the effect of lowering his reputation in the eyes of right-thinking persons. The words must refer to the person in question. They must not broadly refer to a class of persons, but they must refer to the particular person in question. And the defamatory words must be made public. Okay, that is, they must be made known to third parties. Okay, the case of Tolby versus J.S. Fry and Sons deals with innuendo. That is not direct defamation, but indirectly hurting the reputation of a particular person. The defendants published a caricature of the plaintiff, who was an amateur golfer, in an advertisement for their chocolate, giving the impression he had permitted it for reward despite his amateur status. Now, this is an amateur golfer. Back in those days, an amateur golfer was basically one who did not accept any money for playing the sport. So that was the difference between an amateur and a professional. So if somebody plays a sport for money or accepts money for in relation, in connection to their status in the sport, okay, then that person is a professional. In those days, say for instance, participation in the Olympics used to be restricted to amateurs. So it was important to distinguish between who was an amateur and who was a professional. So in this case, an amateur golfer's caricature was used by a certain chocolate company in their advertisement, giving the impression that he had permitted it for reward, that is for money, despite his amateur status. Okay, so this was not a direct case of harm to his reputation. This only indirectly involved the harm to his reputation because they didn't even use his photograph. They drew a caricature of him. That is a drawing that appears similar to him. Okay, the court held that while they did not state it outright, it was still constituted the wrong of defamation. Okay, so that was a case of defamation by innuendo. Okay, that is not by directly stating something, but by indirectly hinting at it. Okay, now here are a few pointers as regards the tort of defamation. It is not a tort to defame a deceased person. That is, you cannot defame a dead person. Okay, it is not a tort to defame a class of persons unless the plaintiff can prove that the statement refers particularly to him. Okay, it is, so you can say that all politicians are dirtbags. Okay, as long as it refers to a class of people and not a particular person, that person cannot claim the tort of defamation. Okay, it is not necessary that the person making the statement should have intended to defame a particular person. So intention is not necessary in the case of defamation. Okay, vulgar language, which merely amounts to an insult without being defamatory, is not a tort. So vulgar language is different from defamatory language. So vulgar language, which amounts to an insult without being defamatory, is not a tort. Okay, and the following may be used as defenses to defamation. Justification by truth, that is, truth is a defense to defamation cases. Fair and bona fide comment, that is, legitimate criticism of someone or something is allowed as a defense in defamation cases. And privilege. Now, privilege does not refer to what we normally understand it as. Privilege refers to, say, for instance, in the case of legislative privilege, okay, something said within the House, something said within the bounds of the Lok Sabha or the Rajya Sabha or any of the state legislatures, okay, even if it may per se be defamatory to someone, it is not to be considered defamation. So that is legislative privilege. Similarly, if something is said during court proceedings, it also amounts to privilege. Okay, it won't be defamatory. Okay. Now we come to intimidation. The tort of intimidation means when A threatens to do some unlawful act, intentionally causing B to do or to refrain from doing some act, resulting in damage to him or to a third person C, A is liable to pay damages in action by B or C, as the case may be. That is, B or C, whoever has suffered. Okay, so the tort of intimidation is basically involves when somebody threatens to do some unlawful act, which causes somebody else to do or refrain from doing something which results in damage to them or to a third person. Then that first person who threatened to do the unlawful act will be liable to pay damages. Okay? It may be noted that in this context, anything one is legally entitled to do, he is also entitled to threaten to do. So that would not constitute a tortious wrong. Okay? Next, we come to conspiracy. A conspiracy is an unlawful combination of two or more persons to do that which is contrary to the law, or to do that which is harmful toward another person, or to carry out an object which is not in itself unlawful by unlawful means. Okay, so a conspiracy basically involves the coming together of two or more persons, okay, to do what? To either do something which is contrary to the law, or to do something which is harmful toward another person, or to carry out an object which is not in itself unlawful by unlawful means. Just make a note that in the English law of torts, even acts that are lawful in themselves, if done by a combination of two or more persons with the intention to cause harm to a third party or parties, even such a combination falls within the ambit of the tort of conspiracy. However, the issue is not particularly settled in the case of India. Okay. Now we come to trespass to land. This is a tort against property. Okay. An act comprises a trespass to land because the defendant broke into or entered into the land of the plaintiff or the close of the plaintiff. Okay. Trespass may be committed if the following actions are performed without lawful justification: by entering upon the land of the plaintiff. Okay. Again, without lawful justification. Okay. By remaining upon the land of the plaintiff without lawful justification, or by doing an act affecting the sole possession of the plaintiff. It may be noted that entry is essential to constitute a trespass. This is distinguished from nuisance, where entry is not essential. Okay. A man is not liable to a trespass committed involuntarily, but he is liable if the entry is intentional, even though made under a mistake. Okay. So the entry into the land basically has to be intentional, and the entry has to interfere with the possession of the plaintiff, okay, to the land. Okay. Now the presumption is that he who owns the surface of the land also owns all the underlying strata. So any entry beneath the surface at whatever depth is also an actionable trespass. Okay. So if you dig beneath somebody's land, okay, beneath somebody's property, that also falls foul of the tort of trespass. Okay. The owner of the land is entitled to the column of airspace above the surface ad infinitum in law. So the possession of the land also includes the possession of the area beneath the land as well as the area above the land. Okay. Practically, it is restricted to such height as is necessary for ordinary use. For instance, you have satellites flying in space, so you don't literally hold the ownership of the land right up to space. But at the same time, you hold it up to a height as is practical for ordinary use and enjoyment of his land and the structures on it. Okay. However, the tort of nuisance must be distinguished from the tort of trespass, which requires an entry upon the land of the plaintiff, since the tort of nuisance is only actionable if it causes some damage, while the tort of trespass is actionable per se. Okay. So basically, the distinction between the tort of trespass and the tort of nuisance is the fact of entry upon the land. Also, in case of nuisance is actionable only if it causes some damage, whereas tort of trespass, your right to land is assumed to be absolute. Hence, the tort of trespass is actionable per se, even if no damage is caused. Okay. Now, the person whose land is trespassed upon has certain rights. He may bring an action for trespass against the wrongdoer. He may forcibly defend his possession against a trespasser, and he may forcibly eject a trespasser. The rightful owner in ejecting a trespasser can use force, but can do no personal injury and cannot resort to violence. Okay. The right of expulsion is not available when the trespasser has gained possession, and legal remedies must be resorted to. Distress, damage, feasant is a remedy by which, if cattle or any other things be on a man's land, encumbering it or otherwise doing damage, he may summarily seize them without legal process and retain them impounded as a pledge for the redress of injury sustained. So basically, if somebody has not directly entered their land, but their property has entered your land and is causing damage or is otherwise encumbering it, that is hindering your rights to it, okay, the owner of the land or the one in possession may summarily seize such property, which includes cattle and such, okay, and retain them as against redress for any injury sustained. Okay. Now we come to trespass to goods, which is again rights, which is again a tort against property. Okay. Trespass to goods is an unlawful disturbance of possession of goods by seizure or removal, or by a direct act causing damage to goods. So if somebody removes a good from where you have placed it, or if somebody seizes a good which is in your possession, either direct or constructive. Okay, or if somebody does something which causes damage to goods in your possession, okay, then in that case it constitutes the tort of trespass to goods. Okay, the plaintiff must at the time of trespass have present possession of the goods, either actual or constructive, or a legal right to immediate possession. Okay, so that is, either the plaintiff should at the point of time when the trespass is committed either have actual possession of the goods, okay, actual or constructive possession. For instance, if I'm standing at the station and my hand is on my bag, then that is actual possession. If I'm standing at the station and my bag is beside me, okay, my hand is not actually on it, but it is beside me in such a way that everybody who sees knows that that is my bag. Okay, in that case, that is constructive possession. Okay, or a legal right to immediate possession. If I've given my bag for safekeeping and I have a token with me, which means that moment I present that token, the bag will be handed over to me, then that is a legal right to immediate possession. Okay, so in such cases, okay, the plaintiff can enforce his right against trespass to goods. Okay, a trespass to goods is actionable per se without proof of actual damage. So this is similar to trespass to land. That is, moment trespass to goods happens, it is actionable per se without proof of actual damage. A person possessed of goods as his property has good title against every stranger, and one who takes them from him, having no title in himself, is a wrongdoer and cannot defend himself by showing there was title in some third person. So even if I've taken somebody else's bag, okay, as long as I have that bag, nobody else can come and take that bag from me and say that I'm returning it to the original owner of the bag. Okay, because as long as I'm in possession of the goods, I can enforce the right to trespass against goods. Okay. Now we come to negligence. Negligence is the breach of a duty caused by omission to do something which a reasonable man, guided by those considerations which ordinarily regulate the conduct of human affairs, would do, or doing something which a prudent, reasonable man would not do. So basically, the tort of negligence involves what is called the reasonable man test. Okay, so if there is a duty to do something, okay, that a reasonable man would do, okay, and something is not done, or if there is a duty to not do something that a reasonable man would not do, and yet something is done, and yet certain action is taken, okay, then that falls foul of the reasonable man test and hence is liable to the tort of negligence. The tort of negligence comprises the following: a legal duty to exercise due care on the part of the defendants toward the plaintiff, breach of said duty, and consequent damage. Okay? Now there's the principle of foreseeability, which says that the duty of care is to avoid acts and omissions which one can reasonably foresee would be likely to injure another. So if I can reasonably foresee that certain acts or omissions would be likely to cause injury to another, then it is my duty, then that duty of care is upon me, okay, to not take those actions. Okay, so this is the principle of foreseeability. Now, there is the principle of proximity in relationship. A relation must exist between the parties for which the duty of care is sought to be applied. That renders it just and reasonable that liability in negligence may be imposed. Now, this principle was expounded in the case of Donoghue versus Stevenson. Okay, now in that case, as we've discussed before, a sealed bottle was sold by a shop. Okay, a sealed drink bottle was sold by a shop. Okay, whereupon the consumer, after opening the bottle and consuming some of the drink, found a half decomposed snail inside the drink. Okay, now in that case, basically the question that the courts were faced with was that since the consumer has purchased the drink from the shop, his contract is with the shop and not with the manufacturer. So how can the manufacturer be held liable? So in that case, for the first time, it was held that since the manufacturer of the drink basically sold it in such a form that not anybody else, not the transporter, not the owner of the shop, nobody else could basically intervene with the goods in such a way as to be able to tell their condition or to be able to interfere with their condition, the manufacturer of the goods sold the goods in such a form that they were intended to reach the consumer in exactly that form. Okay. As a result, it was held that there was proximity in relationship between the consumer and the manufacturer of the goods, and as a result of which, there was a duty of care of the manufacturer to ensure that the drinks were in such a condition as they could be directly consumed after opening the bottle. Okay. And as a result, in this case, it was held that it was a case of negligence as there was a breach of such duty of care. So that was basically the principle in the case of Donoghue versus Stevenson. Now, the standard by which breach of duty is assessed is by the actions of a reasonable or prudent man placed in the same circumstances. Thus, when the circumstances of an act are predisposed to certain consequences, the reasonable man is presumed to have foreseen those consequences and act in a reasonable manner to avoid or prevent the unwanted ones. So that is to say that the reasonable man, so if anybody, if any reasonable person placed in those same, in that same position can foresee certain outcomes of that particular set of events, and it is presumed that the reasonable man will act in such a manner as to prevent or to avoid the undesirable outcomes. So if the defendant has followed those same principles, okay, and has acted in exactly that same manner, then he will be said to be adhering to the principles of a reasonable man test. Okay. Also, the degree of care which a person is required to use in a particular situation in order to avoid the imputation of negligence varies with the obviousness of the risk. That is, if the danger of doing injury to the person or property of another is greater, then the individual is bound to use greater care in order to avoid foreseeable harm. Okay. So if, say, for instance, I have a gun with me, then the foreseeable harm which can be caused by a gun is much greater. Hence, the duty of care in handling that gun is much greater than the duty of care in handling a stick, say, for instance. Okay. So in deciding whether or not there has been negligence, one will have to take these factors also into account. Now we come to strict liability and the case of Rylands versus Fletcher, where the principle of strict liability was first imposed. Okay. There are many activities which are so hazardous that they constitute constant danger to the person and property of others. The doctrine of strict liability states that the undertakers of such activities have to compensate for the damage caused irrespective of any carelessness on their part. Okay. So that is to say, even if they've taken all necessary precautions, all necessary care, as in the case of negligence, the reasonable man test, if they've taken all reasonable precautions, if they've taken all necessary precautions to prevent harm, but the activity itself is so inherently dangerous that it causes a clear and present danger to everybody else or to other persons, okay, then in that case, the doctrine of strict liability will apply, okay, and which states that even if somebody has taken all necessary precautions, they will still be held liable. The basis of liability is foreseeable risk inherent in the very nature of the activities. Okay, so the risk should be foreseeable and it should be inherent in the very nature of the activities. The difference between strict liability and negligence is the fact that even if the doer took all reasonable precautions to avoid harm to the person and property of others, it does not preclude him from liability. Okay, so the difference between negligence and strict liability is that even if all reasonable care is taken, the defendant will still be held liable. Okay, now we come to the case of Rylands versus Fletcher, which propounded the principle of strict liability. Now, in that case, the defendants constructed a reservoir, that is a reservoir of water, by employing reputed engineers, which then flooded a neighboring coal mine. Okay, the engineers had exhibited some negligence in not sealing disused mine shafts they had come across. But the defendants could not be held vicariously liable, for since that the engineers were independent contractors and not servants. So since they were independent contractors, the owners of the property could not be held vicariously liable. Okay, the engineers would have to be held liable on their own. Okay, since they were agents or independent contractors and not servants. Okay. The court laid down a new basis for liability, stating that the person who for his own purpose brings on his land and collects and keeps there anything likely to do mischief, if it escapes, must keep it at his peril and is prima facie answerable for all damage, which is the natural consequence of its escape. Thus, the rule in Rylands versus Fletcher established that there must be a non-natural use of the land and there must be an escape of something which causes damage. Now, the following exceptions were read into the rule of Rylands versus Fletcher. Act of God, okay, that is one case where the rule of Rylands versus Fletcher would not apply. Wrongful act of a third party, plaintiff's own default, artificial work, maintained for the common benefit of the plaintiff and defendant or with the consent of the plaintiff. And finally, when it is the consequence of an act done for public purposes in the discharge of a public duty under the express authority of a statute. So usually if something the government has done, okay? Now we come to the principle of absolute authority, which is something that was propounded in India in the case of MC Mehta versus Union of India. This basically comes in the wake of the Bhopal gas leak tragedy. Okay, it came about when the Supreme Court was hearing another case, which was called the oleum gas leak case. Okay, so this case related to the escape of oleum gas from a factory. Okay, the Supreme Court held that the rule of strict liability did not meet the needs of a modern industrial society, where hazardous or inherently dangerous industries were necessary to be carried on as part of the development program. The court laid down two principles for establishing liability. That is, first, if an enterprise is permitted to carry on a hazardous or inherently dangerous activity for its profit, the law must presume that such permission is conditional on the enterprise absorbing the cost of any accident. And second, the enterprise alone has the resource to discover and guard against hazards or dangers and to provide warning against potential dangers. The court also laid down that exemplary or punitive damages may be awarded. That is to say, extra damages may be awarded in cases of absolute liability because it is to serve as a lesson to all others in such a situation. So in this session, we've basically discussed some of the principles which relate to tort law, okay, as have been used to ask questions in the CLAT exam. I hope this session has also been useful. Okay, so this brings us to an end of the legal reasoning portion of the CLAT paper. I will keep trying to post videos answering challenging questions in the CLAT papers or challenging sample questions. Okay, in the meanwhile, do keep practicing and all the best with your preparations for the CLAT exam. Bye.